As ambassadors of God's kingdom, we are alert to improve our ministry. It makes us anxious to understand what Jehovah has to say for us in His Word. This anxiety raises questions, and our Heavenly Father, through His organization, provides the answers. We are indeed very happy to have Brother Franz with us again to deal with some of these Bible questions and the answers thereto. Brother Franz.
In Matthew 1:1, we read, the book of the history of Jesus Christ, son of David, son of Abraham. In Romans 3:24, we read, it is as a free gift that they, the believing sinners, are being declared righteous by His undeserved kindness, through the release paid by Christ Jesus. What is the difference between Jesus Christ and Christ Jesus? The Christian Greek scriptures open up with the expression Jesus Christ in Matthew 1:1. They close with the same expression in Revelation 22:21. The Apostle Paul was the one that introduced the expression Christ Jesus in Romans 3:24, and he is the only Bible writer who uses this expression, except for just two uses of it by the Apostle Peter in his first epistle in the King James Version, not in the Revised Versions. In the Authorized or King James Version of the Bible, the expression Christ Jesus occurs only 54 times, whereas the expression Jesus Christ occurs about 184 times, or more than three times as often as Christ Jesus. The word Jesus is a name, meaning Jehovah is salvation. The angel told his prospective foster father, Joseph, you must call his name Jesus, for he will save his people from their sins. On the other hand, the word Christ is a title, meaning anointed one. It means the same as the Hebrew word Messiah. This title, Christ or Messiah, is used in the prophetic scriptures before A.D. 1, to foretell the coming of this one whom God would anoint with his Spirit to be king of the new world of righteousness, but without directly foretelling his earthly name. Likewise, at his human birth, the angel announcer said to the shepherds out in the fields near Bethlehem, there was born to you today a Savior who is Christ the Lord. In David's city. Note the word order, not the Lord Christ, but Christ the Lord. The title Christ could be added to the personal name Jesus after his water baptism and his being anointed with Jehovah's Spirit, at which time he became Christ or the Christ. After Simon Peter made his confession that Jesus was the Christ, the Son of the living God, Jesus sternly charged the disciples not to say to anybody that he was the Christ. When Jesus cast out demons from obsessed Jews, and these demons shouted out, you are the Son of God, Jesus rebuked them, and he would not permit them to speak, because they knew him to be the Christ. So, when Jesus was on earth, no one ever called him Jesus Christ. He himself was the only one that referred to his own self as Jesus Christ. And this was only once, privately, when in prayer with his disciples, shortly before he was killed. He prayed, "This means everlasting life. They're taking in knowledge of you, the only true God, and of the one whom you sent forth, Jesus Christ." It is quite evident, therefore, that the expression, Jesus Christ, which his apostles took up after this, means Jesus, who afterward became the anointed one of Jehovah. Jesus, who was consecrated by Jehovah's anointed. So, on Pentecost of 33 A.D., Peter said, "Let all the house of Israel know for a certainty that God made him both Lord and Christ, this Jesus whom you impaled." Hence, for the first time, Peter used the expression to the conscience-stricken Jews, "Repent, and let each one of you be baptized in the name of Jesus Christ for forgiveness of your sins, and you will receive the free gift of the Holy Spirit." In the other expression, Christ Jesus, the Apostle Paul puts the title Christ before the personal name Jesus. This corresponds with putting the official title before any office holder's name, as, for example, King David, King Solomon, Governor Zerubbabel. Accordingly, the expression Christ Jesus calls attention first to the office occupied or held, and then identifies the office holder by name. Christ Jesus, therefore, means Jehovah's anointed one who bears the earthly name Jesus. It literally means anointed Jesus. And at once it reminds us that Jesus is Jehovah's official servant and is to be honored as such servant, he being the only one occupying that office in fulfillment of Bible prophecy. Although Peter and the others of the 12 apostles were anointed with Holy Spirit, we do not speak of them as Christ Peter, Christ John, Christ Paul, and so on. Only Jesus do the scriptures entitle Christ Jesus. In the expression Christ Jesus, the personal name Jesus is preceded by his exclusive official title. Hence, it is to be noted that not once do the scriptures put another title ahead of Jesus' name, such as Lord or King, to form combinations like the Lord Christ Jesus or the King Christ Jesus. The expression our Savior, Christ Jesus, in the Greek text, has the pronoun our between Savior and Christ, and hence merely identifies who our Savior is. This is in keeping with the expression Christ Jesus, our Savior. Now, we do read in 1 Timothy 2:5, "There is one God, and one mediator between God and men, a man, Christ Jesus." However, the expression, "a man," is not a title, but calls attention to the fact that Christ Jesus was once a man on earth, the same Jesus. Consequently, it is only after the already betitled expression, Christ Jesus, that we find titles added, but not further titles inserted ahead of this expression, Christ Jesus. So we twice read the expression, Christ Jesus the Lord. And three times the expression, Christ Jesus our Lord. However, before the expression Jesus Christ, we do find a title inserted sometimes. Repeatedly, we read the expressions the Lord Jesus Christ. All this proves that titles were not multiplied before our Savior's personal name, Jesus. But if one title preceded already, then any other titles were added only after the personal name. From this, it is seen that the Scriptures treat the expression Jesus Christ on a different basis from the expression Christ Jesus. What is the place that is called in Hebrew Har Megiddon? And how can it be said that Jehovah's Witnesses are assembled at that place now? And since when? The name Har means mountain. The name Megiddo means rendezvous or assembly of troops. Consequently, Har Megiddon would mean the mount of the assembly of troops. This explains why the armies of the kings of the entire earth move there. They march to attack the troops that are already assembled at Mount Megiddo. Megiddo used to be in the land of Jehovah's chosen people. So the people or troops already assembled there must be Jehovah's chosen people, the remnant of the anointed followers of Jesus Christ in this time of the world's end. For they are the object of hatred by all the nations of the world and are the target of their attack. They are engaged in a spiritual warfare as they advertise God's kingdom and are equipped with a complete suit of the armor from God. That is why all the nations and their rulers feel emboldened to attack them in order to stop their proclamation of God's established kingdom. Jehovah's remnant of spiritual Israel, the remnant of anointed followers of Jesus Christ, are thus identified with Har-Mageddon. They are really represented by Har-Mageddon, the place, or the mount of the assembly of troops. The place is not what is under attack. It is the people that are there on their own territory, Jehovah's people. Satan the devil had been cast out of heaven and down to this earth by the year 1918. It is after this event that he, by his inspired utterances, through his visible worldly agencies, gathers all earthly kings and their armies to Har-Mageddon to attack those who preach the good news of God's kingdom and who therefore stand for that established kingdom. Ever since Jehovah's remnant of anointed witnesses were restored from their Babylonish captivity to their theocratic place in his ministry in 1919, they have been assembling to the place called Har-Mageddon. The particular assembling of the remnant class continued on till 1931 in fulfillment of Matthew 14:31. By then, a full remnant were gathered to Har-Mageddon. Because of the spiritual prosperity and expansion that they enjoy, all the nations yield to Satan's influence to attack the remnant at Har-Mageddon. Since 1931, the kingdom message has gone forth in increasing volume, and due to this enlarged proclamation, the Lord's other sheep have been assembled to Har-Mageddon, to the side of the remnant, to become with them one flock under one shepherd. All nations resent having some of their citizens flock to the spiritual remnant at Harmageddon. The nations readily submit to being gathered by the inspired utterances coming forth from Satan and his visible agencies. Those inspired utterances gather them to Harmageddon. The purpose of the nations is to inflict at Harmageddon a defeat upon the remnant and their companions, just as Pharaoh Necho of Egypt inflicted defeat on King Josiah of Judah. However, the nations will be the ones to suffer the Harmageddon defeat. Jehovah's remnant and their companions will thereafter depart from that mountain or a place of assembly of troops to devote themselves to the peaceful arts of Christ's thousand-year reign. They will then not have to fight against the world rulers of this darkness, against the wicked spirit forces in the heavenly places. Armageddon battle will reach its climax in the abyssing of those devils with their wicked machinations. Then, the war footing or embattled position symbolized by Harmageddon will pass away from Jehovah's Witnesses on earth. At John 3:16-17, what world did God love so much? And what world did God send Jesus not to judge but to save? Was it the new world? In John's account of Jesus' life, the English word world is translated from the Greek word cosmos. Cosmos occurs at least 79 times in the original text of John's account. Fundamentally, cosmos means order. That is, a constituted order, an arrangement, an ordering of things according to a certain design, an arrangement of things according to a certain pattern. However, whenever in John's account we read the word cosmos, we must not in every case at once think of a world made up of heavens and an earth, the heavens being composed of invisible controlling spirit forces, and the earth being composed of human creatures subject and submissive to the control of those invisible spirit forces. Hence, when we read the word cosmos in John, we should not at once think of such kinds of world, which have been or will yet be associated with this earth. As for example, the Edenic world of Adam and Eve's innocency, the world outside the Garden of Eden, or the world of the ungodly before the flood, the present world of the heavens and earth that are now, and the coming new world of new heavens and a new earth. If we always think of such worlds, whenever we come to the word cosmos, we're going to run into confusion and wonder which is the one of those several worlds that is meant. For example, take John's first four uses of the word cosmos or world. We read, "The true light, which gives light to every kind of man, was about to come into the world." First time. "He was in the world." Second time. "And the world," third time, "came into existence through him. But the world," fourth time, "did not take notice of him. He came to his own home, but his own people did not take him in." Now, into what world did Jesus come as the true light? It is true that this occurred during the time of the so-called world, made up of the heavens and the earth that are now. But is this the world that John 1, 9 to 11 means? Was this the world that came into existence through him? Was this his own home to which he came, but none of which took him in? We must keep in mind that Jesus came out of the invisible higher spirit realms into the visible, lower, earthly, or fleshly realms. This is why he said to the Jews, "You are from the realms below. I am from the realms above. You are from this world. I am not from this world." Here Jesus was identifying one world with the realms above and another world with the realms below. He said that the people from the realms below were from this world. He himself, being from the realms above, was therefore not from this world. What then was this world? Oh yes, it was an established order or an arrangement, cosmos. But for there to be an order or arrangement, there have to be things or people to be set in a certain order or to be arranged a certain way. It is clear then that the word world in its usage by John here would mean the people who are in a certain arrangement or constituted order and subject to a certain system of things. Now, to return to John 1, 9 to 11. Jesus, the true light that came, that gives light to every kind of man, was once about to come into the world. That is to say, come in among the arranged people, or the people subject to a certain order. Jesus came from above, from the realms above, from among angels. And he came among people on earth, human creatures living according to the order of things that prevailed among them. As long as he was in the flesh, and particularly during his public ministry, when he sought contact with all the people, the lost sheep of the house of Israel, he was in this world of people. He was the Word of God, by means of whom all things came into existence. Hence, Jesus Christ was responsible for the existence of this world of people, although not exactly responsible for the arrangement or constituted order according to which they lived and worked. Did this world of people take note of him? John 1:10 says that it did not. That is, the majority of the people did not do so. They clung to their preferred order to which they conformed. They wanted no change. So his own people, creatures who owed their existence to his original work, did not take him in, not even the Jews. But did nobody at all accept the light or take note of him or take him in? Right afterwards, John 1:12 says that some did so. It says, "However, as many as did receive him, to them he gave authority to become God's children, because they were exercising faith in his name." Since the greater part of this world of people treated Jesus that way, it could be said that the world hated Jesus. When Jesus' own half-brothers said to him, "Manifest yourself to the world," Jesus said to them, "The world has no reason to hate you, but it hates me, because I bear witness concerning the world that its works are wicked." For this reason, Jesus did not manifest himself to the world of people, but went up secretly to the feast at Jerusalem to thwart attempts of the world of people to kill him out of its own hatreds. For the greater part, the world of people did not love him, and they would not love those who came out of this world of people and became Jesus' followers. So he said to his apostles, "These things I command you, that you love one another. If the world hates you, you know that it has hated me before it hated you. If you were part of the world would be fond of what is its own. Now, because you are no part of the world, but I have chosen you out of the world, on this account, the world hates you." In order to hate, the world has to be made up of people, creatures with the capacity to hate. Jesus did not pray for these haters, this hateful world of people. To his heavenly Father, he prayed, "I make request concerning the men you gave me out of the world. I make request not concerning the world, but concerning those you have given me. Also, I am no longer in the world, but they are in the world, and I am coming to you. They are no part of the world, just as I am no part of the world. Sanctify them by means of the truth. Your word is truth. Just as you sent me forth into the world, I also sent them forth into the world. I make request not concerning these only, but also concerning those putting faith in me through their apostolic word, in order that they may all be one. Righteous Father, the world has indeed not come to know you, but I have come to know you, and these have come to know that you sent me forth." Now, in this connection, whom was it that the Heavenly Father, Jehovah God, loved? Was it the whole world of people of whom his apostles and later believers ceased to be a part? Let Jesus answer these questions in his own prayer. "I in union with them, not in union with the world. And you in union with me, in order that they may be perfected into one, that the world may have the knowledge that you sent me forth, and that you love them, not the world, just as you loved me, because you loved me before the world's foundation." God loved those who loved the one whom he loved, his Son, Jesus Christ. The world of people did not love the Father's beloved Son. Those who ceased to be one with the world of people and who became one with Jesus Christ loved him. Those in union with Jesus Christ were the ones whom the Heavenly Father loved. This excludes the world of people from the Father's love. Any of this world of people who desired to come into the Father's love had to quit hating Jesus as the world was doing. They had to separate from this loveless world and had to love God's Son and come into union with the Son. These become the ones whom God the Father loves, just as he loves his Son. On the basis of this understanding, let us now consider John 3:16-17, over which the original questions were raised. The verses in question read, "For God so loved the world so much that he gave his only begotten Son, in order that everyone exercising faith in him might not be destroyed, but have everlasting life. For God sent forth his Son into the world, not for him to judge the world, but for the world to be saved through him." Jesus' words here do not refer to that large, comprehensive arrangement or constituted order made up of symbolic heavens and earth, the heavens and the earth that are now. Jesus is here talking about people living on the literal earth and living according to a certain order or arrangement, as they are living under the invisible ruler of this world, Satan the devil. Certainly, God did not love the symbolic heavens composed of Satan the devil and his demons. Hence the word world that Jesus said God loved. This is a restricted world and does not include the symbolic heavens that are now. Certainly, in sending his son into this world of people on earth, Jehovah God, the Father, was performing a loving act toward this world in taking steps to save people of this world instead of destroying this world of people outright with every member of it. It was an action of love toward this world. No particular individuals in this world of people were singled out, although Jesus was sent directly to the lost sheep of the house of Israel. Thus, anybody and everybody of this world of people could take advantage of what God was doing through his Son, because it was a loving act of God for the benefit of anyone and everyone in this world of people. God's giving of his Son was an expression of love for the world of people living under the ruler of this world, Satan the devil. This did not mean, though, that everybody of this world of organized people would respond to that love and would come into God's love and prove worthy of God's love. That was why, without naming names of any individuals and without specifying any certain persons, Jesus added the conditional words in order that everyone exercising faith in him might not be destroyed but have everlasting life. It is only everyone exercising faith in him that will have everlasting life. Those not exercising faith in him will be destroyed. Those not exercising the necessary faith prove to be in the majority. For which reason, the world of people in general, without naming names, will be destroyed. So, from being a general love for this world of people, Jehovah's love becomes a specific love for those who exercise faith in his Son and who love his Son and come into union with him. These are the ones who will have everlasting life in that righteous new order of the future, and who make up a part of its new heavens and new earth. They are really people of the new order, for by coming into loving union and association with God's given Son, they cease to be a part of this world of people. God knew that there were lovable persons, or persons who could become lovable in this world of people. He, with his discerning eyes, knew that there were individuals who by birth were a part of this world of people, but who were really not in heart harmony with the sin of the world, and who desired to get free from the condemnation that was due to the sin of the world. Hence, God did not send his Son into this world of people to pronounce a blanket condemnation of this entire world of people, an indiscriminate condemnation of every member of this world of people, without first an opportunity to show how individuals felt about the world's condemnable sin and sinfulness. So God sent his Son into the world of people for the world to be saved through him, not judged by him. This is not saying that all the world of people will be saved through Jesus Christ, God's Son. It is saying that the opportunity is open for anyone and for all to be saved without partiality to anyone. Nevertheless, the world of people becomes judged. This is the meaning of Jesus' words later on to a crowd of Jews. Now there is a judging of this world. Now the ruler of this world will be cast out. And yet I, if I am lifted up from the earth, will draw men of all kinds to me. I have come as a light into the world, in order that everyone putting faith in me may not remain in the darkness. But if anyone hears my sayings and does not keep them, I do not judge him, for I came not to judge the world, but to save the world. He that disregards me and does not receive my sayings has one to judge him. The word which I have spoken is what will judge him in the last day. Not all the people of this world get saved. Not all this world of people escapes judgment that results in a condemnation to destruction. Even though Jesus, at his first coming, did not come to judge and condemn the world of people in its entirety. Why does not the whole world of people, therefore, get saved and escape judgment? It is because, as Jesus said, he that exercises faith in him is not to be judged. He that does not exercise faith has been judged already. Because he has not exercised faith in the name of the only begotten Son of God. Now, this is the basis for judgment, that the light has come into the world. But men, not angels, have loved the darkness rather than the light, for their works were wicked. Consequently, the only ones of this world that do not get judged down and that get saved are those who put faith in God's Son and come out of the world's darkness into the light, in order that their works may be made manifest as having been worked in harmony with God. Except for these, the world of people in general get judged as unworthy of salvation. Concluding now the discussion, we say that the world that God loved so much, and that he sent Jesus not to judge, but to save, is the world of people on earth, as represented by those members who break away from the worldly organized people and who exercise faith in God's gift of his only begotten Son, and who then come into union with him or into association with him, proving themselves to be worthy of God's love through his only begotten Son. Such faithful believers and followers are reserved for everlasting life in God's promised new order of new heavens and a new earth. Now we have time for only one more question. In connection with water baptism, why is it appropriate to say that one dies to one's past course of life instead of to one's own will? How could that apply to Jesus' water baptism? The word will denotes a faculty with which God has gifted intelligent creatures, by which they consciously and deliberately decide upon a desired course of action. It is the God-given power of choosing one's own actions. It is the conscious process of willing. When a Bible-instructed believer makes an intelligent, prayerful dedication of himself to Jehovah God through Jesus Christ, he does not die to this faculty of will. In the very act of dedicating himself, he had to exercise his willpower with great strength and resoluteness in order to make this decision for all eternity. In order to take the step of baptism in water, he had to exercise his faculty of will in obedience to the command of God through Christ. After his baptism, which symbolizes his dedication to God, he has continued need of the faculty of will. He does not become a machine without will, an automaton or robot or puppet moved or operated solely by the will of someone else. He has to use his will more consciously than ever before to make his future decisions in harmony with the written word of God, and oftentimes in agreement with the instructions that come through God's visible organization. He has to determine what God has willed, and then he has to will in harmony with what God wills. He has to decide in favor of what is to the best interests of God's kingdom and of God's organized people and of himself as a Christian. For example, he may have to decide whether he should get married or not. Hence, he has to exercise his will as to what his decision should be. In support of this fact, the Apostle Paul wrote, "If anyone thinks he is behaving improperly toward his virginity, if that is past the bloom of youth, and this is the way it should take place, let him do what he will or wants. He does not sin. Let them marry. But if anyone stands settled in his heart and has no necessity, but has authority over his own will, and has made this decision in his heart to keep his virginity, he will do well." As regards widows, the apostle says, "If her husband should fall asleep in death, she is freed to be married to whom she wills or wants, only in the Lord. She has freedom of will, but not without limitation. She has a freedom to will to remarry only to the extent of marrying a man who is in union with the Lord." Hence it is that when a grateful Bible student lovingly makes a dedication of himself to God and symbolizes that dedication by water baptism, he dies to his past course of action, not to his faculty of will. In the past, his course of action was designed to please himself or creatures whom he liked, respected, or feared. After his dedication, as symbolized by water baptism, he pursues a new course of action, that of pleasing Jehovah God by doing that which God has willed. Wisely then, he trains his conscious will power to make decisions conformable to what God wills. Of course, the word will has also the meaning of that which is willed, a desire or wish. It is in harmony with this meaning of will that we pray, Our Father in the heavens, let your name be sanctified. Let your kingdom come. Let your will come to pass, as in heaven, also upon earth. From this standpoint, when we take the step of dedication, we come to do God's will, and no longer our own. But to do God's will henceforth, we must always keep in mind what it is, or what we must determine and learn what God's will is. Then, we must will consciously, intelligently, deliberately to do it without fear of creatures. Jesus always did God's will, even as a carpenter at Nazareth, even as long as he continued subject to his earthly parents. He said, I have come down from heaven to do not my will, but the will of him that sent me. When Jesus, about the age of 30 years, came to do Jehovah's will in fulfillment of Psalm 40, 7 and 8, he died to his past course of life on earth. How so? Why, he quit leading the life of an obscure citizen of Nazareth out of the public eye. He laid down his carpenter tools. He stepped out from any subjection to an earthly parent, whether Joseph or Mary. He left home where he had certain responsibilities as the oldest and firstborn son of the family. He undertook to carry out certain vital fulfillments of God's law through Moses, as pertaining to the priesthood, as pertaining to the prophethood, like that of Moses, and so on, and especially as pertaining to the kingship, to which he was an heir through King David of Jerusalem. He devoted himself to the interests of the kingdom that John the Baptist was announcing. After taking this step and being baptized in water to testify to this step, Jesus still had his conscious will power. He had not died yet. His will had always been to do God's will, whatever God's will was at the time. He merely kept on doing God's will, just as he had in the past. However, in doing God's will after his water baptism, he had to exercise his will more firmly than ever before. Why? Because it was now Jehovah's will to make this chief agent of human salvation perfect through suffering. This required the exercise of Jesus' will to decide to face sufferings and go through with them. He himself has suffered when being put to the test. And under test, he had to will to hold true, loyal, and obedient to God. Although he was a son of God, he learned obedience from the things he suffered. To keep on willing right, he had to offer up supplications and also petitions to the one who was able to save him out of death with strong outcries and tears. And he was favorably heard for his godly fear. When he was in an agony and his sweat became as drops of blood falling to the ground, he prayed to God, let not my will, but yours take place. That required the strenuous exercise of willpower. After Jesus was baptized into death and was raised from the dead, he still had his willpower. When Peter asked the resurrected Jesus concerning the future of the Apostle Paul, the resurrected Spirit Jesus, manifesting himself in the flesh, replied, "If I will that he tarry till I come, what is that to you? You follow me." Consequently, the glorified Jesus Christ in heaven is now exercising his willpower in harmony with his dedication and in full accord with his model prayer to God, "Let your will come to pass as in heaven, also upon earth." It therefore remains appropriate to say concerning the water baptism of the dedicated candidate, as stated in the Watchtower of July 1st, 1955, page 403, paragraph 8, quote, "It means his past course of life is buried as by the immersion in water, and he comes up from the water to do only God's will and walk in newness of life thereafter." Thank you.
Now, the attendance of this Sunday morning session. Yankee Stadium, inside 80,412, outside 41,247, total 121,659. Polo Ground, 41,633, outside 5,466, total 47,099. Grand total 168,758.